Before we dive into the presentation, I'm going to take you through a quick overview of what's coming up, what's in store today. So first up, we're going to talk about why is technology important. I know that it's quite obvious for everyone. I can also understand that's precisely why most of you are here today. But I think it requires a little bit of discussion before we look at what we can do using technology. So that's something we're going to discuss first. After that, we're going to look at what all is out there. What are our options as teachers? What are the platforms? What are the tools? And what all do we need in order to engage with technology? I'm going to specifically focus on four digital platforms or tools, if you want to call them, that teachers can use for their CPD. I've promised Prerna and team to cover all the four in the given time, but just in case I'm not able to, don't worry. I'm going to share a resource that will cover all of them, and the presentation will be on the Firki portal for you to look at later. I'm also going to look at the not so good side of technology. Of course, there are challenges and issues around using technology, so we'll have a quick peek into that. And lastly, of course, I have to end with some tips and strategies, some help, as I mentioned earlier, from the learning I've had in so many years. The report says that internet usage in India reached 627 million in 2019. And if you read the faint font just below that, it says that it's driven by rural internet growth and usage. I just wanted to put this in perspective. This is not specific to education, but this is across India. But it should give us some perspective of the penetration of internet and by default, because of that, digital platforms and devices into all our lives, right? Internet is everywhere. Internet technology is everywhere. And because of that, we really cannot walk away from it. It's something, even if some of you have said you don't really particularly like it, I think I would be bold enough to say that it's not about whether we like it or not anymore. It's everywhere, and we will have to engage with it to give it a chance. We may not like it still, but good to give it a chance. While I was preparing this presentation, you know, I just noticed that from the time I wake up in the morning until the time I sleep, there are very few tasks that I don't do using technology. And if you observe that about yourself, I think it establishes the importance of technology very strongly in education specifically. Secondly, of course, you know, it's very obvious. It connects us to the world. There is unlimited access to information that we previously did not have. Just to give you an example, while I was preparing for this webinar, a couple of weeks ago, I posted a tweet for my Twitter friends and teachers to help me with their opinions and what they felt about technology. And it really helped me put together this presentation. So I had access to so many people at the same time. And just at this moment, I would like to thank all of them who responded to my questions. And just another point about technology is, I don't know if you've noticed, but it is a great equalizer. By that I mean that often, you know, we want to reach out to more important people or important voices in our society, we often get stuck in hierarchies. And if you notice, the number of people who tweet to great political leaders, to big names, or even other peers across the world who are from the same domain has increased manifold because of internet. And I think that is a brilliant opportunity for teachers there. So, if you speak about the education domain, if you have a special teacher or simply if you want to get in touch with teachers from another country, it's possible now and we don't have to go through different modes of communication. Third point I have about why technology is important today is it can potentially help us reach large numbers more effectively. This was a very important question that has come up from some of you. I noticed in your registration responses. Yes, technology has a great potential to reach scale if used appropriately, and we will talk about it a little more later in the webinar when we speak about communities of practice. And lastly, I think more specifically as teachers, it's very important for us as teachers and educators to engage with technology, to really experience what it is to learn using technology, for us to be able to facilitate similar effective experiences for our learners, because more and more our students and learners are going to engage with technology more intensely than we ever did. So I think it almost becomes our responsibility to try it ourselves and bring our learning to our classrooms. What you see on the screen is a continuing professional development framework that British Council has developed for teachers specifically, which outlines 12 professional practices that teachers should develop in order to progress in their careers as teachers. If you see the one highlighted in purple, one of the 12 professional practices is integrating ICT, which becomes very important in today's time. So it's almost become, I would say fully that it's almost mandatory for us as teachers to give it a chance, if not like it. We're going to move on to what all is out there, right? What all can we do using technology? If you can see your screens and the colorful boxes there, you can see communities of practice online and face-to-face as well. I should have mentioned face-to-face as well, but both are possibilities. Webinars and blogs, videos, podcasts, books, apps, e-books and journals, online conferences, online distance courses, and moderated online courses. So if you see the color scheme on the screen, the green ones are absolutely free. The amber ones are free or paid sometimes, but the red ones are definitely paid most of the times, right? So today we are going to focus on a few of these. Moving on to the next slide. So today we are going to focus on podcasts, communities of practice, using audio in the classroom, and apps. The reason behind making this choice for you and selecting these particular things to discuss today is because, as you can see, three of the four options are free, so you don't have to worry about accessing them. Also, many of you have responded in your registration questions that you want something for the classroom as well. And at this point, I want to make a distinction between using technology for CPD or for one's own development as a teacher, and using technology for teaching in the classroom. While there is, of course, CPD in both, there is a slight overlap, but today we are going to focus mostly on how you as teachers can develop yourself using technology. However, I have put one option for those of you who want some ideas for classroom as well. Can one more click, please? Yeah. So it is an audio program, usually in a series, that you can download and listen to online as well. It can also be an offline resource. You can download the podcast on your phones and listen to them when you have the time. If you can think about a basic radio program, that's what it is technically, right? Let's look at how can you use a podcast. So of course, I think podcasts are very useful in terms of making oneself updated, keeping oneself updated about what's coming up, because focus on the word series. It means that mostly it's fortnightly or monthly, there are updated podcasts adding up into the series. So you will generally have updated information about your theme or topic of interest. The reason also I would like to focus on podcasts quickly here is because I think it's the most underutilized resource by teachers specifically. It has huge potential for development, but I don't hear many teachers using it. But so I want to urge all of you to explore this resource. Moving on to the next point, the podcasts are mostly free. and they range from a variety of topics. So even if you are in the domain of education, you will have topics ranging from teaching and classroom practice to policy, education policy, really. The next one. I think it also has a great potential to be just simply listening practice. For those of you who are looking at improving your confidence or your own exposure to the language, this provides a brilliant opportunity. And the last one, I think, is my favorite one. Again, a suggestion for those of you who want to try this for your classrooms. You can definitely create a series of audio podcasts for practicing of listening skills as well as speaking skills for your learners and bring that into the classroom. I think if you do this, it will be a great opportunity for developing your learners' critical thinking skills. There are several skills involved in developing a podcast, so that's a brilliant opportunity for your learners. I think you will be bringing in authentic content of that in the classroom that the learners will have co-created the content that you bring into the classroom. Of course, I think it's more applicable for learners who are slightly older, maybe in the secondary grades, but I think it's something you should definitely try. The next one, please. Next point. I think the most wonderful thing I like about podcasts is that it can easily fit into your daily routine. It can, as I call it, a CPD on the go. I usually listen to podcasts when I'm on my way, you know, in a Bombay local, Mumbai local, on my way to work. And it's brilliant time to listen to podcasts and shutting out all the stress that's happening around you. At the same time, you're able to do a little bit every day towards your own development. However, there is, moving on to the next point, there is a small disadvantage. I wouldn't say disadvantage, really a drawback, if I may say so. Podcasts are not as interactive as other options out there, but I think it's a brilliant way to get in-depth information about a particular topic. So if you have an area of interest, I think it's a good option to explore. I have a list of podcasts for you to look at on the next slide. Yes, so here's a list of podcasts. There's EdChat Radio, there is Every Classroom Matters, House of EdTech for those of you interested in education and technology. It's a 10-minute teacher podcast that explores classroom practice. For those of you who are already familiar with the Firki portal, there are Firki podcasts coming up, so you should definitely watch that space. There is a Teach English Radio from the British Council, which is technically not a podcast, but it is a radio series that you can download and use offline as well. And there is another upcoming British Council podcast called Focus on Education. For those interested in education policy, it is releasing on the 11th of December. So please watch out that space. It's recording audio for your classroom. So from your own development using podcasts, we can move on to your classrooms for a little bit and check how we can use some basic infrastructure that we have, such as smartphones that we carry every day with us, to not only improve our own selves as teachers, but also possibly bring that into the classroom, right? Can you move on to the content, Prina? Yeah. Okay. So how can you record audio? I think all of us have done that at least once in our lifetimes when we've used smartphones. You can easily also download an app for recording audio from Google Play Stores. There are several of them available there. Now, how can you really use audio recording? So one way is to record yourself while teaching and use that for reflecting on your lessons. You can also focus on the language if that is an area that you're working on. But I think it's a brilliant way to reflect on what happened in the lesson. And especially if you don't want to look at the visuals of the lesson, but just just watch what you're seeing in the classroom. I think it's a very good way to reflect on your teaching and what you're seeing in the classroom. You can also improve your own English. You can watch out for errors or pace of speech. And I think this is also a brilliant opportunity again for learners. If they can, if you can encourage them to record themselves and bring their own attention to their own errors or pace, or even the content, how they've organized the content, I think then there are a set of skills that you're developing for your learners, which is brilliant self-awareness, self-correction skills. So there is going to be a lot of, you know, proactive correction that learners can engage in. The next one, please. And most importantly, if you get a chance to record your learners or others that others who can also provide for a voice, maybe somebody important in your school, a celebrity, if you land up meeting somebody, I think that becomes a really authentic listening text that you can bring into the classroom, just like podcasts that we talked about. Okay, so using audio for your classroom or for your own professional development doesn't really have any specific disadvantage, but this applies for audio and video. It's very important to seek permission from people who record, especially learners. If learners are involved, then definitely we need to get parental consent for engaging in these activities, because that's a big part of using technology to be safe and to keep our students and learners very safe in the process of development. I have some, can we move on to the next slide? Yeah. And also, you know, it's not again a disadvantage, but you do need some basic infrastructure. You definitely need a smartphone. You also definitely need maybe a basic speaker if you want to play the audio in the classroom. So there are basic infrastructure requirements, but I suspect we all have that in our daily lives. So, of course, an app stands for an application. It can be installed on your smartphones. I don't have to tell you that. I think most of us do it every day almost, and can be used for entertainment, education, and news updates. But how can you use apps really? Again, first point, please. Yeah. So again, apps can be used for your own professional development. You can engage in language learning or any other skill that you are interested in. There are several apps out there. But what is most interesting about apps that I've liked is that they have bite-sized information. Most of them have chunks, as you've rightly identified earlier. Preeta, if you could move on to the next point. Yeah. So the bite-sized information, it's 1 to 5 minutes of chunks of information that is stored especially for the purpose of learning. If you're using apps especially for the purpose of learning, then that's a advantage, I would say. Again, a brilliant option for CPD on the go, for people who are struggling with time. The next one is, again, an element I like about apps is most apps have an element of gamification in them. And I've noticed from my own personal experience that be it adults or children across age groups, we all like playing games, we all like winning, we all like to see how far we've progressed, we like to beat each other's records. And I think that is that makes it a lot of fun. And definitely, if you're having a lot of fun, you're definitely learning more. So that's an element I like about apps. The only disadvantage could be that they may not necessarily always give you in-depth information about a topic or a subject, as opposed to podcasts, for example, right? So it's the only disadvantage that you may want to consider before deciding what apps you want to use. I have some suggestions for you to use apps. So this slide is focusing on the apps for your own professional development. So you have the TED Talks. For those of you who have been watching TED Talks on your computers in the past, they also have an app now, and it's full of insightful videos on a variety of topics. There is Evernote, which I have used extensively and I've really loved. While I was doing my online distance masters, I often have studied, at airports on in the trains on my way to somewhere, and Evernote has always helped me make comprehensive notes or even clip online resources and store them in one place. But there are more uses to Evernote. I really urge you to explore. There is Penzu, which helps you to reflect on your teaching. It also sends you reminders to reflect. I think that will be brilliant for teachers. Of course, there is YouTube. Again, a very potentially strong resource to look at classroom videos, posting your own classroom videos as well. However, again, a note of caution there. Remember to keep your learners safe, yourself safe. So if you're sharing something on YouTube, I strongly advise that you keep it a closed access group and share the link only with people whom you trust, if in case you're using that. There is WordPress, which is for blogs. You can read or even post your own blogs and connect with teachers and educators across the world. And there is a Firki app as well, which hosts all the information that is there on their website as well. I don't have the logo here, but that's also something you can explore. There is another set of apps for your learners or for your own development. Can we move on to the next slide? There are apps for classroom use as well. Thanks, Prina. So there is one called Sounds Right. This is a British Council app that focuses on your English pronunciation. There is an app called Seesaw where you can have student digital portfolios, and there is a separate app for communication with parents as well. My favorite ones are Kahoot and Quizlet, because these are apps that I was talking about. There's an element of gamification. You can review important topics that you've done in the classroom, turn them into a quiz for your learners, and it's really fun. And the last one is Edmodo, which is a social media tool for educators. And there is again a separate app for parents if you want to host homework and you want to share resources or answers. This is just a limited list. There are lots of apps out there, so this is just some of them that I've used. Some of them I know other teachers have used that I've put together. Yes, a group of people informally bound together by shared expertise and passion for a joint enterprise. And I am very glad I can see the word shared so many times in the responses you're posting on the chat. I think it's very important to make the distinction between just a group of people who come together and a group of people who have a shared interest and who have shared common objectives and goals and enterprise, as the definition says, because that is what really defines a community of practice. So how can we engage, how to use social media groups most effectively? The reason I'm diving into social media groups is because I think that's the most common way of all of us to engage in communities of practice, isn't it? I think I will be very surprised out of all the participants today if anybody's not at least on one WhatsApp group or a Facebook group for your own development. If you aren't, you can explore that. But I'm sure that you're at least part of a family WhatsApp group. So social media as such, Facebook, WhatsApp, and Twitter are the most accessible platforms for all of us, free of cost, and we all have explored them in one way or the other, right? But it's very important to understand how to use these groups most effectively, how to get the most out of these groups. Can we move on to the next point? Yes. So definitely there is a potential to use at large scale in social media groups. I would like to take a moment to respond to some of the questions that I saw in the registration responses. One specific question was how to use technology for reaching a large scale. And I think social media, online communities of practice are a very good way to try to do that. We've recently tried that in a British Council project in Maharashtra, where we connected teachers from across the state on WhatsApp groups, on Twitter chats and Facebook groups, and we explored that option of facilitating continuing professional development for teachers. Can we move on to the next and the next one? I think there was a yeah. I think it's very important. All this is well. We all are on groups, and I think you will agree that we need to agree on guidelines on these groups. It is very important for all the members of the group to agree on a common code of conduct, if I may call it, to be able to benefit the most out of these groups. I've met teachers who love to be on these groups, but they often say that if we can only do away with the good morning messages, or if we can only do away with the wishes, all of us understand that they are, well meant, but not for a community of practice. I think it's very important, therefore, to agree as a group to what is that joint expertise that you all want to, what is that shared interest, and to be able to develop what is it that you agree to do or not do on a group. Moving on, I think it's also very important to engage. If you are on a WhatsApp group or a Facebook group specifically, it's very important to share or to at least to respond to others' ideas, ask questions. Although there is a lot of research that says that even passive engagement can benefit participants on these groups, I personally also feel that if you are part of a WhatsApp or a Facebook group, then you are also subscribing to a community, right? You are part of a community, and there has to be give and take in the community. And therefore, I feel that one has to engage proactively on these platforms. If you don't have any original posts to make, that's fine. You can ask questions on what others post. So there are different ways of engagement. Most importantly, discipline yourself. I would strongly suggest that it's very important to, keep time away for engagement on these platforms, because they can easily become very overwhelming. And that is one reason why teachers really walk away from these eventually, because they are so consuming. After a point, there is a rush of messages and one doesn't know what to engage with, what to not engage with. So definitely one way to discipline yourself really is agreeing with the community that you're part of. If you can chalk out a schedule or a time that you agree to use only for specific engagement on the group. So for example, Fridays 8 to 9 p.m. is when all teachers in this group will engage and talk to each other. In that way, you limit the time. That way, you make the engagement more predictable for teachers and more effective. And that way, teachers' WhatsApp groups are not spilling out of control, right? Yes, we all know this is a disadvantage of social media. Can be very overwhelming. A lot of information and very few people interact. On an average, in any WhatsApp group, there are, let's say there's a WhatsApp group of 30 to 50 people, there are not more than 5 people who actively engage or proactively share information on the group. So that, yes, that's a challenge. And that's why I precisely said that if you are part of such groups, you should really engage, because others should also benefit from your posts. And the last one, disadvantage, I would say, is it's very difficult to draw a line between professional and personal lives, right? Because, for example, I have a community of practice on WhatsApp on my phone, and at the same time, I have a WhatsApp group where I am a part of a family group. So on social media, it's very difficult to draw a line between your professional groups and your professional engagement and your personal engagement. And definitely these will merge at some point. For those of us who have the luxury of having another phone, you can choose to have professional communities of practice on a separate device if possible. Or for instance, I have a separate different Facebook profile for my professional development. I have a separate Twitter handle for my professional development. That's my way of making that distinction clear of when I engage professionally and when I engage personally. I think that's a very important thing to effectively engage with social media for your communities of practice that are online. All right. So where are these online communities of practice? I'm going to talk about Twitter right now because I'm sure that you are already familiar with WhatsApp and Facebook groups, but I'm not sure how many of you have engaged in Twitter chats, hosted Twitter chats, or at least participated in one. So I have some suggestions for you to explore Twitter chats that take place regularly. One is ELT chat, hashtag ELT chat, a long running weekly chat for English teachers with a useful repository of chat summaries. There is EdTech chat, there is EdChat, and there is EdLit chat, which is a sort of a virtual book club if you're interested. And there are many more. You should explore definitely. And I have personally found, as you've seen in my introduction, I used to absolutely hate Twitter, but once I started using it appropriately and I started drawing a line between the personal and the professional, I absolutely enjoy Twitter the most for my professional development now, because it automatically limits my engagement in CPD using technology. It's not overwhelming at all. I choose whom to follow. A lot of it is in my control, so I really like it. But there is no force for you to like it, but I definitely urge you to explore it. The next bit about online COPs is definitely Facebook groups. Very simple solutions to joining online communities of practice. There is a Firki Facebook page, and they also have Twitter and Instagram handles. British Council also has a Teach English in India Facebook page, and we also are present on Twitter. So if you don't want to spend a lot of time selecting what you want to engage in, these are ready-made options for you to start exploring at least. Okay, so there is a not so good side of technology as well. And most of you have already mentioned a lot of challenges in your responses when you registered for the chat. The first one, of course, is there's a lot of information out there, and it definitely can be overwhelming. There is no doubt about that. There are too many options as well. Very difficult to filter what is authentic, what is not, or even what is useful for you and what is not, right? It can definitely, technology, use of technology, especially social media, can consume you, and it can be very difficult to switch off. I remember when I had posted a question to prepare for this webinar on Twitter, one of my friends on Twitter had asked me how to switch off, can you deal with that in the webinar? And I think my only answer to that is I cannot tell you how to switch off. I can tell you a couple of strategies you can use, but it is really up to you. You have to consciously do them, really. That is one. Next one is, sometimes there is no need to use technology. Sometimes it's just possible to go up to somebody and speak to them face to face. And often I've seen teachers, especially being under pressure to use technology in the classroom, most importantly, because generally there is a lot of pressure on teachers from parents, from the systems to use technology to demonstrate that we are up to speed with times. But I really urge teachers to filter those opportunities and question before you use technology whether you really need to use an audio or a video, or are you enough in that moment for your learners? And lastly, technical glitches. And we've had too many in this webinar, you've seen already. It's important to not lose your cool in that case and just trust that everything is going to be well. But most importantly, jokes apart, if you are predicting technical glitches, you definitely need backup plans, right? And the first point there, I think it's very important for us to verify all information you get online and never take it at face value. I'm sure you must have heard about WhatsApp University. A lot of us receive a lot of information on WhatsApp, or social media or through other sources that we need to really verify before believing. And similarly, moving on to the next point, which is very connected to the first one, it's also our responsibility to post authentic and verified information as far as possible. And especially if you're part of a community of practice, to ensure that there is quality information on your community of practice, there is, I think there is a responsibility that we all have to verify all that we post. The next one is important to practice digital detox. Absolutely. So my answer to my friend on Twitter is engage in conscious quiet time or off-screen time. One example is that was generally on Sundays, I absolutely don't look at my phone. Most of the times I'm successful and many of the times I'm not. But it's very important to draw out that time in the day or in the week when you are off screen. As I mentioned earlier, one way to also do that is you plan your CPD, you plan your engagement on social media for the week. You can identify a Twitter chat that you want to be part of, or if you have agreed on a time with your community of practice members that we are going to engage in a WhatsApp chat, maybe from 7 to 8 p.m. on a particular day. If you plan a little ahead of time, you're less likely to get into the trap of accessing anything and everything you get through the week. So that is that strategy works for me. Still, having said that, I still haven't got over my habit of checking my Twitter the first thing I wake up. So it doesn't always work, but I have more hope in you all. The next one, I strongly suggest you do little but regularly. You can, and that is where the bite size element comes into play. You can look at a small piece of information daily or once in 2 days, but what is important is regularly engaging in it. That's what's going to build your CPD really together. Because if you remember, if you notice, engaging with technology for your CPD it depends a lot on your proactive initiative. It depends on your discipline. It depends on your planning. It really starts from you. You have to direct it. And for that to happen, if you do a little regularly, you're more likely to build on your skills rather than doing a lot in a particular week and dropping it for some other weeks. I think it's very important to be open-minded with technology. I really suggest Twitter works for me. I absolutely dislike Facebook for some reasons. But I know teachers who really find it very comfortable to engage on Facebook rather than on WhatsApp or Twitter. I don't think there is one right digital platform or tool. The good news is that there are many options. It's really up to you to try them and see what works for you.
Just a quick update. We're at exactly 6:30. Radhika?
Not necessarily saying anything is fine. You need to be open-minded to practice passive engagement as well on some platforms, especially Twitter. Where you can read others' tweets, look at what people are saying and not say anything. And that's absolutely fine as far as you're benefiting. But again, to reinforce my point that I made earlier, if you're part of a community of practice consciously, then I think there's some amount of engagement is recommended, right? I also suggest that for those of you who don't have much experience with Twitter chats or using different platforms, it could help to shadow others. If you know another teacher who has experience in using it, You can shadow them. You can watch them engage in it. You can reflect together on it. Or another way of shadowing is, that's how I learned how to engage in Twitter chats. I got on Twitter at a specific time for a specific Twitter chat, and I just watched what was going on for an hour. I did it a couple of times and I understood how to engage. And the next time I joined the Twitter chat, I was able to engage quite effectively. So that is one strategy you can use if you don't have much help in terms of learning new skills. The next one is, it's very important to learn additional skills. I think this is the most important point. And again, this has come up when I sort of engaged in a crowdsourcing activity on Twitter for preparing for this webinar. One important point that came up is how to filter information, for example, how to know what is authentic or not, how to plan. All these are additional skills that are really going to help you engage with technology effectively. Sometimes more than the platform itself, it is these skills that will take you somewhere in your journey with technology. So it's very important to reflect on these things. Using technology for CPD is definitely not only about what tools and platforms there are out there. It is also about how you engage with them. And that is very important to define for yourself. Most importantly, it's very important to be safe. Be careful while using technology. Be careful about posting messages, pictures, personal details online. This point is rarely talked about, but I think it's the most important, especially for our learners. If you're posting classroom videos, as I suggested earlier, if you're posting pictures, if you're posting audio or videos of anything, it's very important to get the necessary prerequisite consent from parents and learners or other teachers before you post anything online. That is, I think, my last tip for you. That's it, really, from my side. So for those of you who want to know more and who want to explore more options, there is a Technology for Teachers series that British Council has worked on. It is a free series of, individual guides that takes you through each platform or tool. For example, using online e-moderated courses, how to host Twitter chats, etc. So there's a series of them online freely available for you to download and use offline later. There is the Teach English Radio I talked about. There are teacher development films for those of you who want to watch other teachers practice certain techniques in the classroom. Again, all of these are free. There is the Firki website, as Rahul mentioned, where a lot of the British Council content is also hosted. And then there is the Firki app as well, which you can download from the Google App Store. That's it from me. Thank you very much for being such a lovely audience today. A lot of chat going on there. I'm happy to take any questions if you have. And if I'm not able to answer all your questions, please reach out to me using my email or my Twitter handle. I'm more likely to respond to you on Twitter. So I'm happy for you to catch me there as well. I think the ones that I use is definitely in terms of posting messages, if I may say. If I'm posting something on Twitter or Facebook for teachers, I always run that post by somebody, another peer or another teacher or my colleague. I have found that to be very useful. It's not about when it comes to posts, it's not always about safety, but it's also about verifying if what you're saying is really appropriate, or is it going to be applicable. And at the same time, many of us today have, all of us in fact, have the freedom to really say anything on social media, and it's very important to check with somebody. The strategy of checking with somebody before you say something is definitely going to protect you more. That is one. The common ones are not trusting information from odd-looking websites, or generally if you're looking at journal publications, for example, you will always know how many people have cited that article, especially if you are interested in using Google Scholar for that. The number of people who have cited that information will tell you that if the article is widely acknowledged. And that is one way of making sure that you are quoting from the right source. And the most common one is not sharing your personal details, personal account details with anybody. But about safety with your learners, I think one thing that I've noticed with teachers is that they very freely tend to share out of course, sheer enthusiasm of trying something out in their classrooms, or, sheer enthusiasm of sharing something with their peers. They tend to share a lot of their classroom content online for open viewing, which could damage children. We need to understand that there are child protection policies in place in all our schools, and we need to be aware of that. And more, I think it's very important to maybe not share learners' pictures or videos unless you have the appropriate consent from them. So that is the most important part for me. Learners are the most important in terms of safety. I remember this question was asked in the by one of the participants in the pre-registration form.
Yeah.
I as far as I know, and my information could be limited, I think there are apps out there that you can use for M&E for teacher development programs, or even within schools. There are many apps, and there are most of them are paid apps. However, in my experience, most of the M&E that can be done using technology is largely limited to quantitative data, numbers.
Mm-hmm.
I have not come across something that really captures qualitative information, but there could be something. I may be wrong, but that's my experience. So, well, in some contexts like this webinar, for instance, I'm not sure what the backup can be. I think the backup only can be that you do the webinar at another time. But in terms of using technology in your classrooms, whenever I've used technology to train teachers, for instance, I've always had a backup of the traditional pen paper solutions. If I'm using any worksheets online, if I'm using any game online, I've always had a backup of another way of doing the game in case the technology ditches me. I think that is the simplest way to really take care of technical glitches. In other scenarios, if you're using particular reading files or video files or audio files for your teaching or training, what I've practiced previously is upload them on a common drive, share the link with teachers beforehand so that they can download, and then the content is ready for offline viewing. So if you have any internet connectivity issues, that is taken care of. So just to summarize, one is definitely have a pen paper sort of a backup. You need to be prepared with alternate ways of doing the same thing, most likely not using technology at all. And the third one is sending and sharing any content in terms of videos or audio or picture you use for your training or teaching before the training so that they can be used often. It's a very good question because it opens up a lot of themes for me that I would like to definitely address through this webinar. As far as I know, I don't know of any specific course for teachers to learn how to use technology. There could be. There are platforms such as Coursera, and there is FutureLearn. There are these MOOC platforms where you could find something, definitely. However, if you ask me personally, one thing that technology is telling all of us teachers is the really the the direction is through us, as I said. It's really you who will direct your use of technology. And there is no better way to learn than to start engaging in whatever you are interested in. I think that's the best course if that helps you. It's how I've learned. I've seen many teachers do the same. It's very important to bring the focus back on the teacher and say that, okay, let me try. Let's not wait for a course as such, but let me try. Let me start doing something and learning from it. But I'm not at all saying that doing a course is not the way to go. Definitely there is value in it, but I don't particularly know of any course offhand. I can find out for you if you want. Yes, I think again, Nadeem, a brilliant question as always. Yes, I think I'll go back to my point I made when I talked about the not so good side of technology, that sometimes we tend to use technology when we don't need to, when there are options. No, I don't think CPD needs to be online. There are different ways of engaging in CPD using communities of practice that are face-to-face. Reflecting, maintaining a reflection journal, just a plain paper, pen and paper solution is one. Talking to other teachers, observation, seeing other teachers' classrooms. There are so many other ways of engaging in technology. I think when we start talking about CPD using technology is when we often don't have these opportunities, which are more obvious and maybe more effective even, and or to add a dimension to our development by using online courses. So both have their value, and there are options for both face-to-face as well as online options. Addressing your question on whether there are online resources from the British Council, yes, many of them are free, as I've listed already on the slide. There are also some online courses for teacher development. If you they are paid ones, and you will find more information on the British Council website. The most of the resources that are on the slide are free. They can be downloaded and can be used as offline resources. That was also one of the questions that came up in the registration forms, that what are the offline resources? For those of you who are not connected very well to the internet or in remote locations, you can definitely download some of these resources and use them later. That's a very big question, and a lot of it sort of opens a can of worms, in my opinion, but a very important one as well. I think the term blended learning is used quite often and very easily across the education domain. I cannot say really how effective it is. It's definitely there is value in trying something out in a blended format. Especially if you are short of time, if your participants are remotely located, if you want to bring in that element of technology in the classroom appropriately, definitely there's value. But most importantly, how effective it is depends on how you use it. If you're using technology where it's not required, it's not going to be useful. I think the one of the most effective ways I have seen teachers use technology, but the caveat, I don't have data to support this, but it seems to me that a good way of using technology could be having a majority of time for face-to-face interaction and having some sort of a homework element that is online. One thing I personally have tried with my teachers is I have in the past set some homework on WhatsApp for them, and I had got a lot of rate of response was very high compared to anything else. So that was for me very effective. But the most important thing to remember is both the teacher and the learners have to be well oriented to what you're using and what you're calling as blended. And there has to be a larger institutional buy-in as well for it to be effective.
Is there any circumstance or situation where you've seen it blended learning as a model might be effective for teacher training in your experience so far?
Yeah. British Council itself, we have a blended course called My English for teachers to learn English, where there are face-to-face lessons, and there are tasks for teachers to do later. But face-to-face in the sense they're online face-to-face lessons. And then there is the coursework that teachers have to complete. And that, in our experience, has worked brilliantly in order to also bring teachers from different locations together, teachers who don't often find time in their routine to travel to a particular location to learn. So that model for us has worked pretty well.